I'm lucky to doing this for 12 years, but I want to win. Everything I do, I want to win.
The Monaco Grand Prix, the jewel in Formula One's crown. A lap through the Principality streets is one of the most intense experiences in racing. And exactly 25 years ago, on the day that this episode is released, Monaco was won by a French driver racing for a French team. That man was Olivier Panis, and he is my guest this week. Welcome everybody to Beyond the Grid with me, Tom Clarkson. Particularly for those people who were there, that 1996 Monaco Grand Prix is etched in the memory. The conditions on race day were horrible. There was not only rain, but a grey murk that wouldn't lift and gave the Principality a slightly haunted look. There were other strange details as well. David Coulthard raced in Michael Schumacher's helmet, Damon Hill retired from the lead, and only three cars completed the race distance. And the driver at the front was that man, Olivier Panis. It was Olivier's only win in Formula One, and he remembers it like it was yesterday. As he tells us in this podcast, you won't believe how close he came to not finishing. And he also tells us how the win changed his life. But there's a lot more to Olivier's career than just that win, fabulous though it was. He contested 157 races, scored 5 podiums, and worked with some of the most famous names in racing. Alain Prost was his boss for 3 years. He worked with Mika Häkkinen at McLaren, raced alongside Jacques Villeneuve at BAR, and led the Toyota team. Had he not had that leg-breaking accident at the 1997 Canadian Grand Prix, and had he not turned down Williams, yes, true story, who knows what he might have gone on to achieve. Olivier is a fascinating man, and he has a lot to say. I hope you enjoy our conversation. Olivier, it's great to see you. First up, how are you? Where are you living these days?
Well, thank you, Tom. I'm very well, thank you. I live in Grenoble and I just arrived at home now.
When I say Formula One to you, how much do you stay in touch with it all these days? Do you still watch every race?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, I'm still looking everything by like 4 or 5 years ago, even in Japan or somewhere with the jet lag. And the change time, I wake up like 3 o'clock in the morning to looking the free practice, all this kind of testing. But now, if I'm wake up, I do it. If I'm not, I'm not useful of this today. But all the Grand Prix, I'm looking.
And it seems to me, tell me if I'm wrong, but French motorsport seems to be in a very good place at the moment, particularly in Formula One, when you think we've got the race back at Paul Ricard, we've got Alpine joining, of course, this year, we've got Pierre Gasly, Esteban Ocon. Is that how you see it? Do you think it's in as good a place as it's been in for the last 20 years, almost since you were in Formula One?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, yeah, I'm very happy and very, very proud of now we have some very good French drivers, because after me for a long time, badly by different situation, we don't have a French driver anymore. Luckily, we have very strong drivers like Gasly. I very love him. I think he's very, very good driver. Ocon, I believe also, but in it, you know, is one with 1 year off is difficult to catch very close type of driver like Ricardo. But I think what he showed was pretty optimistic for the future.
Are these things cyclical, or why are there so many good French drivers in Formula One? Is it because French industry, French government is supporting grassroots motorsport in France?
Not really. I mean, the federation do the best to help French drivers, of course. But I think for us, was the problem. It was when we have a Loy is right. We have the Loy, it can sell the cigarette manufacturer and all the alcohol sponsorship. And for French people like me, we have huge support by the brand of cigarette, and help a lot of the young drivers. When we have this law cut everything, in France it was a disaster, and it takes a long time to recover and to find a solution to help the young French driver to come back to Formula One. One thing also help is the some different academy, like for Pierre Gasly, Red Bull. This was pretty successful. But in France, we don't have much anymore. And I think Nicolas Todt did a good job with Charles Leclerc. Okay, he's not French, but you know, he managed himself to promote some young drivers. But you know, it's not enough for sure. If the cigarette come back or this kind of big company in France help, like the fuel people, like Total help a lot, Romain Grosjean. But we don't have the same support we have by the past, this for sure.
At what point in your career did the tobacco money and all those other French sponsors get hold of you?
For me, it's no point. If I don't have fuel sponsor and the cigarette sponsor, I don't even thinking about doing Formula One. I never be in Formula One, for sure.
Without them?
Without them, sure not. Even if I have my personal sponsor try to help me the most he can, but with these people, for sure, I'm never going to Formula One one day.
Olivier, just describe to me what it was like driving for a French team. You made your debut back in 1994 with Ligier, but a French team, you're a French driver, you had French sponsors. Was it a lot of pressure? How did you feel coming into that first season?
To be honest, you know, I was so happy to come to Formula One. I really don't care about this this pressure because my first race in Formula One before Flavio Briatore by Ligier, I have a contract race per race. I'm going to Brazil. I don't know if I'm going to the next one because the situation of Ligier and this time was financially quite bad. And but you know, I was so happy to arrive in Formula One. I don't even thinking. I don't care about this. I just want to enjoy myself, to show for you guys and also to our business, I try to doing well. And when Flavio buy the team, he was in May in 1994. He said, I want to keep you. He signed me a contract for 2 years. And this it just was, for me, it was a dream. When you put one foot on the monocoque of Formula One, you just say, wow. I'm here, I need to do my best, and that's all. I don't think much about the pressure for my career, really.
That probably helped you as a driver.
Of course, because I know where I come from, and I was lucky to doing this job. When you have a chance to achieve, you just enjoy.
How would you describe your relationship with Flavio?
I need to be honest with you. For me, he was fantastic boss for me. He was very clear person with the driver. He said, if you do your job, you have your space on this team. If you're not doing your job, I mean, I give you a chance. If you don't achieve, is the life. And even when we make a party for the 20th anniversary of Monaco in Monaco, we have a dinner with Flavio and Mr. Honda and all the people more or less was there 20 years before. And I feel the same people. I feel the same guy. For me, Flavio, he was a very clear person. If you're thinking about how this job is hard and demanding a lot, if you don't have the people like him give you the way you need to achieve, sometimes you make some mistake.
Yeah, it slightly depended what kind of a character you were, I think, whether you got on with Flavio as a driver.
Exactly. For me, it was clear with him. We are all the time very open to talk. If I'm not happy, I go in straight to see him and I say, look, we're not enough competitive. We need to push that. You need to push that. The easy way with Flavio, he said, even when we have a meeting with all the board and the technical meeting, he said to all of us, he said, I don't understand much about motor racing, but just you need to let me know what we need to have to be quick, which machine you need, which people you need. And I feel the approach of him, he was pretty like very good manager, and he managed to find the right people around him to perform. I have nothing bad to say to Flavio. Sometimes he was rude, strong, but I have argue more with Tom Walkinshaw to compare to Flavio, to be honest, because he was different personality, and Tom, he was really on the fight to take the best of you.
Did Tom Walkinshaw talk to you about French rugby as well?
Yes, but he gave me a bad time, Tom. Very a bad time. When I understood this guy and when I know him better, And one day, when I won in Monaco, he was not in Ligier anymore. He jumped to the motorhome, even if he is not good relationship before he leave with all of them. He don't care. He go to the motorhome to speak to me and he say, you know, I give you the hard time that I believe you need to achieve. He was strong, but he was a pretty good guy. And he was just, but he pushed you hard to your delivery, your best you have.
Well, look, you've made a couple of references to Monaco 1996. And I do want to talk to you about that because you've mentioned the 20th anniversary. Well, this year, Olivier, it's the 25th anniversary. Time is slipping away.
Frenchman Olivier Panis from Lyon leads the Monaco Grand Prix in his Ligier Mugen Honda. And that's Irvine and Salo and Häkkinen. Oh, my goodness. And I think we're only going to have about four cars finish the Monaco Grand Prix. And Olivier Panis for Ligier Mugen Honda, a wonderful fillip for the French team and their Japanese engine supplier, exits the RAS-CAS to win the 1996 Monaco Grand Prix, an incredible result. Oh, look at that for joy. Victory for Olivier Panis and Ligier that nobody could have expected in a Monaco Grand Prix, which, as ever, was full of incidents. It has, in fact, been a great day for Formula One.
When we talk about that race now, just how do you reflect on it 25 years later?
I remember everything I was doing during this race and everything happened in this race because it was completely crazy race, really. I mean, starting 14, he start raining beginning of the start. So many things happen during this race. You don't even know what's going on in the end. And well, I remember everything, even the people talking to me the 15 last minutes. I don't have enough fuel to going to the finish line. Talking to me in Italian, French, English, every language the people we have in the team try to help me to go to the end, or even someone to say we need to pit. And we have some big argue during the last 15 minutes, but it was fun. It was funny. It was funny because I know how much this victory was important for the people I work with, because he was the survivor of the team, more or less, even for me.
Now, a couple of things there. First of all, how much did you back off in those closing laps because of the fuel problem?
You don't believe how much. I don't pass the sixth gear anymore. During the tunnel, I left off the throttle very, very soon everywhere. And I know David closed the gap to me, and I push one lap to show him, now, man, you don't pass me anyway. And after the race, we talk with David, and he said, even if I catch you, I know I have no chance to overtake you. Because this victory is what maybe is the first one I get. And it was the first chance I have to win the race. For sure, nobody overtake me. Or if you want to overtake me, you need to pass over me. Otherwise, there's no chance.
There'll be more insights from Olivier in just a moment. But before we continue, I want to know how many of you have dreamed of being a Formula One team principal. Think you could handle it? Then why not give it a test drive with F1 Clash? F1 Clash is a motorsport management game for mobile from London-based developer Hutch. If you haven't tried it before, give it a go. It's in full 3D and looks really impressive. From Yuki Tsunoda to Lewis Hamilton, you can collect your favourite drivers from the 2021 Championship and race on every track on the official F1 calendar. Play the role of team principal, tune your cars and plan out the race strategy, and just like the real races, you'll need to make split-second management decisions to take first place on the podium. Make sure you keep your wits about you in the heat of the race as you react to weather changes and time those all-important pit stops, and push your team to the absolute limit in nail-biting duels with real players from all around the world to become a racing legend. It's all to play for. Download F1 Clash for free on the App Store and the Play Store. Did you always love street tracks? Did you always love driving in the wet? Did everything happen for you that day to bring you the victory? Did it play to all of your strengths?
Well, I love the street race. I was pretty competitive every time on the street race. I love the wet condition because I love to drive. I love to slide. I love is why maybe after many years I doing the Trophée Andros. I don't know. But anyway, I love this condition because I know sometimes the driver making a small difference, even if he don't have the best car. But the Monaco race, this time in 1996, I know the car technically we have. I know the car when we have maximum downforce, it was pretty good car. And 1 week before, it was in Nogaro, I prepare Monaco also for the drivability on the engine. You don't imagine how much effort I put to prepare this race, because I know my car was good in Monaco for technical point of view and the engine point of view. I remember the first field practice, we on the top four all the time. Even my first set of qualifying before the problem happened, technically I was P4. I know this car give me something on this race. I don't believe the victory, to be honest. I need to be honest with you.
What did you think was possible when you woke up on race morning from 14th on the grid? What did you think might be on?
The point is, during the problem when we have in qualifying, when I saw my Japanese engineer cry because we don't fix the problem, and he saw all the effort the team put to be good in Monaco. And, you know, I said, don't worry, man, tomorrow we finish on the point, just to help them to recover about the deception.
Did you really believe that?
Yes, to be honest, yes. When I wake up in the morning, I just opened the windows and I saw the rain. Anne was there. I said to Anne, I finish on the podium today. She laughed at me, to be honest. She laughed and he said, Olive, you start 14. I say, I don't care. I feel something today. She laughed and let me go. You know, she let me go. When I did the best lap time in the warm-up, everybody's thinking we have low fuel and blah, 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 all the bullshit, you know, all the time the people talking. And I was so confident and so happy with my car. And I know I have the fuel to sure to prepare to start the race with this amount of fuel. And I let the people talk. And I know I have something, I have a tool to play today. After that, you need to be lucky like I am. After the race was what the race, but after the warm-up, I'm convinced myself I was thinking to do something in this race. And I was convinced even more after the warm-up.
And what point in the race did you start to think, yes, the win is on here?
The first thing is when we start, I was very be careful on the start because it was very wet. And I know the first corner is maybe crashed there. And it was. And I was very be careful. But when the race is going, and when I saw how much confident, how much I feel good with the car, and I start to overtake some people in Monaco on the wet condition, I overtook 7 cars, I think, before I pit. I just felt, well, it's maybe happened something. And I just carry on. And when I said to the engineer, I said, look, for me, it's okay for slick tires now. He said, but nobody pit, Olive. I said, well, I feel so confident with the car. I think if we want to gamble something is now. And just Damon pit the same time that he was front of me. And he told me, he said, Damon pit. I said, I want to pit now. He's right. And I pit just in the same time of Damon. And when I go out of the pit, I just go out P4. It's already the dream come true. We are close to the podium. You know what I mean? And after that, because everybody is pit after us, we have the hot tires he don't have. And it's why I managed to overtake Eddie, because when he go out of the pit, he was with cold tires. And I know it was the time I need to overtake him, because maybe when the tires of him getting warm, maybe it's not possible for me to overtake him. I need to overtake him very quickly. And it was, I try in loves, but to be honest, I try, I touch him, and I feel my race is gone. I say, well, we crashed, I broke something. And when I go him, hit the tires, And I say, I try to manage, I try left and right, and everything going well. I say, I'm so lucky, but just carry on. And I spoke with the engineer, said, looking the car on the straight line, if you saw something on the noise or whatever. And he told me, no, well, we don't saw something. And I feel the car was so good. I said, well, for one day, maybe lucky. And I just continue to push. And after happened, I do the lap record. The lap record, I fighting with Jean Alesi. Before that, I saw the Damon Hill engine blow up. And I close to span on the oil of Damon on the chicane. Like, also, I say, oh, I'm so lucky because maybe normally that's you crash the car. And I say, maybe it's the day. Now I need to push and we'll see what's going on to the end. This, for one thing, I'm lucky because for me, Damon and Jean have the car to win the race. Damon blew up the engine badly for him. And Jean hit the barrier and I hit the suspension. And yeah, I mean, sometimes you need luck, but I think the race, it was not a lucky race. I pushed myself on the maximum and the car on the maximum to achieve that. But luck is not all the time. But sometimes one day you have luck or one day you have bad luck. And this day is wise for me.
You mentioned that you had a moment on Damon's oil at the chicane. But I mean, let's just think about it. Schumacher crashed out on lap one. Irvine ended up crashing out. Alesi hits the barrier. Did you have any near misses at all?
No, well, I mean, one day I remember because I was a big fan of Senna. And he said on the interview, he said, one day I feel it's not me driving. It was a goal driving. And this day I feel something. It was nothing happened to me. Nothing bad happened to me. Everything I try, it works. And when after I saw the race again on television, and when I saw my car sometime on some position, I say, well, it's not new you're doing this because all the time, every corner, you close to crash. Even that surprised me. I mean, but in the moment when I was on the car, I feel it's nothing happened to me. I feel so confident. And I say, look, the way I'm lucky today, for sure, I finished on the podium.
Was that the only time in your career that you felt like that in a racing car?
No, it was the second time. The time it was before in the Formula Citizen in Nürburgring, it was in qualifying. I start with the first set of tires and I feel so good with the car, so quick and so confident, but easy. I said to my engineer, I say, look, or I 1 second in front of everybody, or we are last. Because for me, everything was so easy. And he just answered me, he said, yeah, you're right. You are 1 second point two in front of everybody. And this feeling I felt sometime, two or three times in my career. But I dream to have this feeling all the time, to be honest. And I want to dream to winning more races. But when I looking back of this, I'm still lucky to win Monaco anyway.
Is it that feeling of invincibility in a car that every driver strives for every time they get in the car?
Yes. I think if one driver, like, I don't know, because in F1 is very, you know, so difficult. When you don't have the car to win, even if you're the best driver, you don't win. This is, for me, is the key. But if you have the best car, and you are confident all the time, like what I said before to you, when you go into the car, for sure, you're invincible. What I saw today with Lewis, for sure, is one of the best drivers in the world. But with the confidence he had, with the team he have, for me, this guy is just unbelievable. Everything he's doing or everything he tried to achieve, he work. And when he don't feel he have the car to win the race, he not to be second, he not to be third. This guy, just you feel the confidence of Lewis today, just unbelievable. When you have this feeling, nobody beat you, nobody.
Just going back to Monaco, how did that win change your life? I assume you were front page of L'Equipe on the Monday morning.
Was. For me, it changed my life just after the race because, first of all, I don't believe of that. Everything goes so quick. I didn't even take the time to feel it. We have this big dinner the Sunday night with all the Monaco people, the Prince Rainier, the all these stars, all these paillettes, when you say in French. Even that, I feel it's not possible. It's a dream or something, you know. But when I wake up in the morning, I was already some magazine people want to take the picture, blah, 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 all day long. And on Tuesday, I need to be in Barcelona to do some tests already. After that, I take time to resign and to sit down and to just thinking about it. Don't change much to me. It changed much or lot to the regard of the people or the looking of the people when he saw me after this victory. Even on the paddock, I feel much more respect to everyone because you achieve something special. This changed a lot on my life after this race. Is the people talk to me or the people look at me. But it was nicely, to be honest, it was nice because the people was nice and the people, you feel you achieve something. But for me, it was not enough. I want, if I do in Formula One and lucky to doing it, I want to be world champion. And it was not happen.
Can you remember what Guy Ligier said to you?
Guy Ligier said to me, thank you very much because we have a bad time with the team. I sold the team before to Cyril de Rouvre. I rebuy the team. I mean, I think it was a hard time for Ligier because he don't want the name disappear. And he just enjoys so much. And for sure, we have a pastis after the race, but I'm going cool. But I'm sure he was flat out until the Monday morning.
If we fast forward to, I guess, that winter when Alain Prost got involved, he bought the team. How different did the team become under Alain compared to when it was Ligier? And
I have funny things. First of all, Guy Ligier for me is one of the guys give a chance for the old French driver by the past. This I have a huge respect of Guy. But the funny things after Monaco is when Flavio saw me and he said, it was 1 month afterward, when he sold the team to Alain. He said, you know what? You are the driver after this victory. I gained so much money because you have this victory. You know what I mean? Because I sold to Alain. And Alain tell me, he said, you know, you are the driver, cost me a fortune. And it was a very funny thing.
Yeah.
Because if I go back to your question, during the winter time when Alain buy the team, we are very pleased. Because Alain is a big name in France. He have a huge support of the sponsorship in France. Everybody locked the door of Alain to be sponsor of the team. If one guy make a team in France, for sure it was just Alain. Otherwise, it doesn't work. And we are happy to have this opportunity to have a lot of budget and to have a team getting better and bigger. This was the opportunity for Ligier and for us, to be honest, for everybody on the team. But one thing we forget a bit is we still have the people of Benetton doing the car. For me, in 1997, it was a Benetton Honda car, to be honest. When I saw something today, people talking about espionage, all these kind of things, I'm just laugh, to be honest. But it was a Benetton with the chassis. I mean, we doing ourselves in Ligier, but it was all the technical point of Benetton. We put Mugen engine, was fantastic engine. And we decide to have Bridgestone tires. And for us, it was the best decision we can achieve because we are more or less alone and in making tires for our car. And this makes a huge difference. And if you remember well, in 1997, before my accident, I think I was P3 on the championship or P2, I don't remember. But the car we have this season, it was just unbelievable. We have a car to fight on the podium every races. And we enjoy so much, even with Alain, with all the people on the team, we enjoy so much every weekend. And after the worst season happened and the worst winter, it was the winter of 97-98, when we making our car really in the factory. And this car, it was a disaster really. But because I think we are so much dreaming about 1997 and we feel we put the finger on something, we believe 1998, we kill everyone. But in fact, it was not the case. If I thinking backward, we have too much success very quickly. in 1997 with Prost, and everybody was nice. Huh? I enjoy so much. Everybody's thinking, okay, we have Alain, we have the sponsor. Now everybody is done. We're here. And in fact, when I was in the hospital and Alain go to see me and he said, you need to stay with us, Olive. Next year, his engine is a French engine, is a Peugeot engine. We make a new chassis. He was convinced himself, we make one step up again. Because on the same time, when he go to saw me in the hospital in Brittany, I have two contracts on my case. It was Jordan of Prost. And he convinced me to follow him. But I'm very pleased to, because he's not forced me to doing it. I'm very pleased to follow him. I was so convinced, French team, French driver, French engine, French boss. I believe of the dream, completely French team have a success. I make a small mistake. But I'm part of this mistake. I give all things I have to have success with Prost Grand Prix, really. Because I think it was fantastic for a French fan and also for Formula One to have like a huge country, to have like a Formula One team, completely French.
Fascinating. Now, I feel I've got so many questions to ask you about what you've just said. But if we go back to 1997, as you say, you were second in Spain, you were third in Brazil. The car was clearly very good. Was it the best Formula One car you ever raced, that 97 Prost?
More or less, yes. After, I think, the Toyota car we have in 2004, it was pretty good car too. Really good car. Yeah, but in this time, yes, for sure, 1997, it was the best car I never drove before in Formula One.
Then you mentioned this as well, but you had that horrific accident at the Canadian Grand Prix. What happened?
What happened, it was a wishbone felt, the rear wishbone felt, and that's all. I mean, it's part of our job. You all the time scared, not sometimes you scare about if part of the car broke and you don't manage everything. And this was happened to me. It was one of the fast corner in the Montreal circuit, and the right wishbone felt, and I hit the tires and broke the two legs. And this time it was the bad time for me, maybe, for sure. But on the other hand, I was lucky to recover and go back very quickly on my passion and try to continue to doing my sport. I know after that I have some hard time because the car in 1998 was not good enough to show something. For sure, and this time I discussed with some big team before my accident because we have so much success. So it's Monaco 1996, 97, the season start like even me, I don't believe. And for sure, I talking with some big team like McLaren, like some touch with Ferrari, but you know, the accident happened. And after the accident, when the year after we have a bad car, you don't show nothing, but you know, it's quite tough. And the people think maybe after the accident, blah, 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 you know, I mean, what I talking about. And that's all, but I mean, I don't regret anything.
Were you immediately aware of the extent of your injuries in Montreal? Because I was looking at some YouTube footage of the accident before speaking to you, and you do try and get out of the car.
My worry is to be handicapped. My worry is to my leg doesn't move, why I feel is more bad to compare with what I believe. Is why I want to feel myself, try to go out of the car and feel everything. My scare it was this. You maybe this accident was a big one. I saw my legs was broken because the crack in my foot I saw was bad. But what I want to be sure I'm not, I feel everything. And when I feel everything and I saw my foot, when I go try to go out of the car, I feel big pain on the left, but on the left it was nothing much. On the right, I feel the foot was blah, 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 anyway. But I was happy everything looks working. To be honest, it was my worry. It is why I try to jump out.
That is Olivier Panis. It's a big one. Olivier Panis, a big one. His head is moving. Let's hope he's perfectly all right. But that was a very, very heavy impact indeed.
How soon after the accident did you have the pins taken out?
Yeah, the 1 hour after the hospital, one of the bigger chirurgeon of this hospital was start to go to holidays. And when he heard on the radio, a driver of Formula One have an accident and badly. And this guy was amazing. And he just turned and go back to the hospital. And when I saw him the first time, and he said to me, well, I'm very passionate of Formula One. When I heard this in the radio, and I don't go to holidays. I need to do something for you. And it was so nice people on this hospital, Sacré-Cœur. And he take extra of me to everything, IRM, scanner. And my first question was to him, he said, you think I go back to the car with the accident I get and with the bone I broke? And he said to me, if you want to doing it, for sure, it's no problem. But we need to operate tonight. And we need to put one pin on the right, completely on the right leg. But if you don't pin, you don't put pin on the left, the right recover quickly to the left. He said, this is your choice. I said, my choice is to be the quickest on the car. I want to race next week. I tell him that, and he laughed. And he said, no, this is not possible. But if we're doing well, for sure, if you work hard, you recover quickly. And I say, okay, we go for two pin. And it's why he put me two pin, one pin on the left and one on the right to recover quicker.
And how long did you have the pins in your leg?
If I tell you, you say I'm crazy, but I know sometimes I'm crazy. He said to me, the first table, when I go back after 3 months in the Formula car, on the Formula One, I did some test in Formula C, in Formula 3 1 week before. And I feel a vibration and pain, to be honest. And when I go back to the F1 in Monaco, Alain was there, everybody was there to say, Olive, don't take any risk, blah, blah, blah. In my mind, I say, look, after the second lap, if the first corner I don't pass flat, for me, Formula One is finished. It's mean I'm scared. When I pass flat, I was happy. And Alain take the radio, he said, Olive, you need to pit now. I say, why? You need to pit now. It's too dangerous. You're crazy, blah, blah, blah. And I don't pit for sure, like usual. And I did 3-4 laps just to enjoy myself. And the point is, and this time I don't have enough power to brake with one foot. And somebody know about this. And I just jump out of the car. I have already still the, I don't know the name.
The crutches.
Yeah, crutches. And I go directly to the technical director, was Loic Bigois. I say, Loic, for the next race, I need large pedal to brake with 2 foot because I don't enough power. But don't tell nobody about this. And Alain was pissed off with me because he said, no, you push too much. You know, you still have the crunches. You need to be careful. Okay, now you know everything going well. And anyway, and I said to Loic, and I call him on Monday again, and I say, you prepare the pedal? He said, yes, I do it, I design and I make it for you. But I said, don't tell Alain, don't tell nobody, just the mechanics. And in Nürburgring, I have this pedal. It was unbelievable for me. And I did the best lap time on the free practice, and I qualified. I finished 6th on the race. And this pedal for me changed my life. And when we take out of the pedal on the car, when I recover of my muscle, I still have the pedal because I racing for 1.5 years with the pin. It was very dangerous if I have again big accident, but it was the risk. I mean, when the doctor say to me, if you have accident with that, it's finished. I say, well, okay. I understood, but for me, I feel good with the pin. I run, I jump, and okay, it's painful every morning, but you know, I mean, we'll see. The last race was in Brazil in 1998, and then I have a big crash in a warm-up, but big, because it was wet, but the line is going dry up, and I was P3 on warm-up, and I won't push, I push because it was so long time, I was not on top of the list. And I touched the curb, was wet. I span and I hit the barrier like you don't believe, man. And I make like a 7 spin. I saw a star on my eye. And I say, ay, 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 my legs. Well, what happened with my leg? I'm looking my monocoque. Everything was disappeared in front of my foot. everything. I don't touch anything with my leg, and I don't have any pain. Just the pain I get, it was, I take 12G on the ass. For 1 week, I don't sit. I was so happy to my legs don't touch anything. I want to take out my pin by the same doctor put in. I fly back to Canada. He take my pin out, and I stay 1 week in Canada, and after that, I go back to France without everything. I feel he out of me something like I don't believe. Like, I feel free when he take out his pin.
Do you think you were quicker without the pin than you were when you had it in?
No.
No.
To be honest, when I'm racing, I don't even thinking about the pin. I say I have a stronger leg now. I know I have something, if I have a crash, it's bad. But, you know, what I do is my dream. It's part of me racing, and, you know, I don't even thinking about the pin.
We'll be right back with Olivier in just a moment. But first this. We know our listeners are a savvy bunch. But this short message is for those of you out there that might have fallen into the habit of browsing online in incognito mode in order to protect your privacy. Because you might be surprised to learn that it's probably not as incognito as you think. It turns out that even in incognito mode, your online activity still gets tracked and data brokers still get to buy and sell your data. Data harvesters can use your IP address to identify you and your location through your online activity. But with ExpressVPN, your connection gets rerouted through an encrypted server and your IP address is masked, making it harder for third parties to identify you and harvest your data. And it's super easy to use. No matter what device you're on, phone, laptop, or smart TV, all you have to do is tap one button, and you're protected. So if you really want to go incognito and protect your privacy, secure yourself with the number one rated VPN. Visit expressvpn.com/grid and get 3 extra months for free. That's expressvpn.com/grid. Once more, expressvpn.com/grid. Right, let's get back into it with Olivier. When it wasn't working at Prost Grand Prix in 98 and 99, how did that affect your relationship with Alain?
It affected a bit. 1999, it was much better to 1998. And we, you know, even the last race in Japan, I fight with Eddie for the third position. 1999, it was a good season for me when we saw where we start. 1998, it was hard because we scored just 1 point with Jarno in Spa. When everybody, after the big crash we have in Spa, if you remember this big crash with David and all these kind of people, it's difficult to say. I was a people push hard to have success. And I think even if you compete with somebody, all this team was my friend because I start with them. All of them was my friend and I want to have success for them too. With Alain, sometimes I argue much. Because I'm not happy with the situation and with the choice it takes some time.
Was it hard to argue with him? Was he one of your heroes growing up?
Yeah, he was. He was my hero. Him and Senna for me was my two driver for sure. I dreamed to be like them one day. But it's not because you are a four-time world champion, you are a good team principal or a good manager. I love Alain. I have a huge respect of Alain. And I think when he takes this post of Alain, it's quite hard for him also to take decisions sometimes. Because when you never do that before, I think it's hard. You need to have people around you or be really straightforward with you and also help you to learn your new job. I don't want to criticize Alain about this situation. When he chose to buy the team, and to be the team principal, you need to learn in 6 months something you never do before. Even if you are working with the big team you're working before, when you are a driver, you are a driver. You are not team principal or not director sportif. You need to learn this job. And I think everybody on the team, because we have Alain Prost, for sure, we have winning car and we kill everyone. And one day, everybody realizes about you need time. Alain need time, we need time, we need to making our experience, we need making our cars. and some choice Alain take and the technical people take because he want to be better to everyone, take some decision, and technical decision was very bad. And we pay, everybody pay for this, even Alain. I like Alain, and we still have very good relationship with Alain. We're really good. But I never want to work again with him. If you don't take the decision, you need to believe of the people trust you. If you want just to believe of the people to make you happy, but he lie of you, but he make you happy, you happy. I don't work like this. And I think Alain understand very much many things after. In July 1999, he called me and he said, I want to have a meeting with you, Olive, to talking about 2000. I say, yeah, Alain, no problem. I'm going to Paris. We sit down together. And he said, Olive, I need to change a lot of things. You want to stay next year or not? I said, Alain, you know, it was really tough 2 years for me after my accident. I recover. I do my best for the team. I try to do my best. But sometimes I don't think so. You listen to me or you don't trust me 100%. I think for both of us, maybe we need to change something. He said to me, okay, Olive, I understand your point, but I just employ Alain Jenkins like a director technical for next year. We change everything. We do a new cars, blah, blah, blah. And he said, please, just make a dinner with Alain Jenkins and after you decide. I make the dinner with Alain Jenkins. I have big respect of him because the car he did by the past was good. When he explained to me on the dinner, the French people is not good enough. The car we make in 1999 finish maybe in the podium in Suzuka. I respect Alain Jenkins. I say, maybe you're right, Alain, but for me, I don't have enough power to restart everything to zero. I need to know who I am, and I need maybe to move and to go into a different team to learn different things. And the morning after the dinner I have with Alain called me and he said, Olive, what do you think? I say, well, Alain, I think you make a good choice maybe with Alain Jenkins, but I don't have enough power to restart everything to zero. I think we need to stop or to take different way. And, you know, maybe one day we start to work again. But I don't feel good about 2000. I don't want to invest myself with something I don't trust. And it's why we decide, I say, for me, I don't want to stay. I don't say where I'm going. I have no idea.
You really had no idea. So you turned down a race drive with Prost, not knowing what your plans were.
No, I have no plan. Likely, I have two good managers. It was Keke Rosberg and Didier Coton. I was very pleased to work with them. But when I tell Keke and Didier about my decision, he said, but Olive, you are crazy or what? We have nothing out. I say, well, you know, sometimes you need to be clear with the people. I know it's pain. Maybe I don't drive Formula One hereafter, but okay, it's the chance maybe I get to change my view of my career, you know. And we start talking in Monaco. We have 2-3 meetings in Monaco to thinking about IndyCar, Formula One, even DTM, different things. And it was funny because it's nothing turned for Formula One. We have a big phone call to America, to Pat Patrick Racing and to Ford official. And he said, I want to meet you and with your manager because I want to propose to you a contract to come to America for IndyCar. I said, well, you need to speak with my manager, call Keke. If you agree to have a meeting together, okay, I come, no problem. And we have a meeting in Cannes with the boss of Pat Patrick Racing and Bobby Rahl. He was Ford, the boss of Ford. And we discuss about the contract and we find a solution and we check in and say, okay, we do it. I say, but we do it. I just want to close on my contract. And Keke and Didi ask, if we have a proposal of Formula One, we stay in Formula One. And he accept. We're making the contract. We send the contract. And for my mind, my head, I'm going to America.
And you were happy with the ovals,
no,
particularly after
no,
your...
No, I'm not happy with the oval. I'm shit myself, to be honest.
But you thought, this is what I have to do.
I need to drive anyway. I'm here to racing. And also, at this time, I saw it was a lot of street circuit. and I'm not too bad on this situation. And I say for sure the Oval was hard, but I have no choice, to be honest. And I say, okay, go for it. And we have, I think it was the contract, we have 2 months if we have something in Formula One, or I go there anyway. And one day I was at home and thinking, and I called Didier and KK and I say, I have one idea. I say, okay, we listen to you. Because you're a good friend with Ron Dennis and Noberhaug, I have idea. Why you don't call them and you ask them if you don't need a third driver and test driver to continue to, because in this time, you know, you have 2 test teams, you have is a huge works and huge many days for a test driver. And KK answered to me, say, you drink something? I say, well, no. You mad or you completely crazy or what? I say, KK, just thinking about this. And Didier, please thinking about this. And Didier called me and he said, okay, I'll call Martin Richmarch and talk about this. Maybe it's what I'm thinking is maybe not a bad idea. And he called Martin Richmarch and the call back to Didier, he said, well, Martin is thinking, I think it's a good idea. And he spoke with Adrian Newey, and Adrian Newey said, for sure we need to do it. I need to have one driver out of the race weekend to give me the true things and just concentrate for the test. And after we spoke with Martin, he quite happy with that, but Ron, he don't want. Ron Dennis said, I want to have Olive in board, but I feel bad to give a seat of test driver and third driver with a guy win a race, win a Monaco, win some race and do some podium. I feel bad to propose that to him. And Didier and KK said, you know, you need to call Ron and to say it for you is okay, no problem. I call Ron, I say, Ron, I don't speak well in this time, even I speak very bad, but I say, Ron, don't worry about I'm a winning driver in Formula One. I want to know who I am and I want to know to drive a best car in the world. You give me a present for me if you accept to doing this together. And he say, okay, let me thinking and go next Monday to the factory and we talk. And the history come like this. And I met Ron Dennis on Monday afterward with Didier and KK. And met Noberhaug, Adrian Newey, Martin Richmarch. We have a big meeting. And I just introduced myself and I explained why I want to doing this. In the end, everybody was happy.
But what about the prospect of not racing, Olivier? Did that frighten you in any way?
I'd make a big risk to decide to doing it. Because if KK and Didier told me, if Mika and David, when we test together, is 1 second in front of me, I did. But I said, look, I don't really care about it.
They won't be. They won't
be. No, I don't say that, really. I don't say that. I say, well, it's a risk, Didier. But I can take the risk because I want to know what is my real potential on the best car. I want to work with this team, that's all. Don't I take the risk. And I call Ron and I say, I agree. I want to doing it. And he say, okay, this is what I propose to you and the salary I propose to you. And when he talked to me about salary, I say, you know, we just the salary you give to me already respect me. Because I don't know why Ron, he feel bad about this, but he pay me very well to doing this job, to be honest. And I say is maybe I make a way also from afterward for different driver to doing this job, because it was very important job for Adrian Newey. And luckily we have a very big success this 2000 season. First of all, I have so good relationship with Newey and all the team. I love this team because outside you feel this team is very cold. I'm scared, to be honest, before I came to them. But inside it was so nice team. I enjoy so much, really.
What was the biggest difference between McLaren and Prost? If there's one thing you could pick out.
What I pick out, I know exactly, everybody know exactly the place of them. It's mean the director technical is the director technical, the chief mechanic is the chief mechanic. Nobody argue. Everybody know what they need to do. This for me was the big difference. No complaint, no bullshit, just working with a good ambience. For me, it was the big difference. And also I need to tell, because I love the people was in Prost and Ligier. I love them. But also to have the best car, it changed a lot of things, Tom, a lot of things. It's mean when you know you have one of the best car and you know every weekend you go to racing and you have the opportunity to win. When you know you go to the race and maybe you fight for the top 10, the motivation is not the same.
How frustrating did it get not being able to race that car? I mean, let's cast our minds back to last year when George Russell got into Lewis Hamilton's car at the Sakhir Grand Prix, very nearly won it. And do you feel that you could have put on that kind of performance in the McLaren in 2000?
When I did the test with Mika and David, all the time, first of all, I want to thank them because he gave me a fantastic welcome, Mika and David, and he trusts me a lot. Even though one day we are on the, which, Budapest, I think, and we have a meeting with me, Mika, and Ron Dennis, because Mika don't want to test anymore. He said, we test too much, I test too much, I'm tired. I want to be concentrated on my race weekend because it's where we score points. And the argue we beat him and Ron, it was hard. Eh? And Mika said, look, we try something. Olive prepare, do the test in Valencia. He prepares Spa for me. I don't test in Valencia. I take rest. I recover my body to be very strong in Spa. He prepare the race in Spa for me. On my head, I just listen. I say, wow, he put a lot of pressure off me. Anyway, we go to Valencia, we're making the job with Adrian, with David, test a lot. I say sometimes to David, David, you test too much. Because they win it. David tests all the time with me, all the time. Mika, he tests sometimes one day, 2 days. But David, he wants to test, he wants to try even. I love them, both of them anyway. And arrive in Spa, we sit down. I mean, we start the weekend, he make the best lap time in free practice. He do all the free practice, he was the best lap time. He do the pole position, he won the race and with the lap record. And I remember all my life this. When he go out of the car, he saw Ron, he said, you know, I tell you, well, if I'm fresh and Olive prepare the car for me, we win the race. I don't want to test anymore. And what is was the funny every day is because Ron said, yeah, tell them he need to test, he need to test. And Ron and Mika say, well, I don't need to test. Look, you know, he work.
There's the proof.
It was so funny. It was so funny because the ambience of the team, it was so good. But this year, I did 28,000 kilometers test on the car. I know the car, it was my home, really. And for sure, my dream is want to race for McLaren one day, like a titular drivers. And we have a long talk with Ron and Norbert about this because Ron want to keep me for a second here, like a test driver again. And I say, Ron, I love to continue with you, but my blood, he want to race. What I know after, I decide to don't continue with McLaren to be a test driver and third driver. I want to racing again. He put a clause on my contract. He leave me if I go to the top five team in the championship. Because he say, no, with the quality you have and what you achieve for us, if it's not that, you don't move, you stay here. And when Greg Pollock called me and Jacques Villeneuve to propose to me to go to BIR, it was P5 on the championship. I say, luckily, again, I'm lucky. And when I announced to Ron, I want to sign to BIR, and he said, okay, it's the deal. You're on the top five car on the championship. Okay, if you want to leave, you leave. I feel sad, but we're happy for what we achieved together, blah, blah, blah. He was so nice with me. But when I said to, if I go back to 1999, when I call Ron, I say, okay, I'm doing with you. Listen that. This was the worst things in my life. I said, you give me your parole. We signed together. Ron asked me that. I said, yeah, it's done. One day after, Frank Williams called me. And he called me, said, hi, Olive, it's Frank Williams, blah, blah, blah. We start to talking and he said, look, I have a proposal to you. I say, yes, thank you. What is the proposal? I give you 1 year contract like a titular driver and with one here option for the second here to race for Williams.
In 2000?
In 2000. When I say yes to Ron one day before, I called Didier and KK. I said, well, you know, this is what happened. And Frank Williams said to me, okay, you have 24 hours to decide because we very convinced we have a good car next year. The question mark is because it's the new BMW engine. In terms of reliability, we don't know where we're going. And I just stopped with Front. I called Didier, KK, and blah, 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 talking. And he said, ah, is the shit happen? I say, oh, look, I say yes to Ron, I don't change. I call back Frank Williams. I say, Frank, because he speaks French too. I say, I'm very sorry, but I say yes yesterday to Ron Dennis to be third driver and test driver. I say no to you. I'm sorry, but if he was yesterday, for sure, I say yes, but now it's too late. And Frank was not happy, and he said, ah, nobody say no to Williams. And I said, no, don't take this way. I just because I say yes to Ron, I'm people like this. When I say yes, it's yes. And it's when Jason Button coming. It was Youngkins coming. Good luck for him and happy for him.
What an extraordinary story. So true to your word, Olivier. True to your word.
Yeah, it was, you know, sometimes I'm not easy man, but when I say yes to somebody, I say yes. Look, is my wife is next to me, is my same wife.
How long have you and Anne been together, Olivier?
34, 35 years.
Fantastic. But I'm still reeling from this story that you turned down the 2000 Williams to go to McLaren.
Yeah, it was not much people know, but even Didier and KK, sometimes you need to think more. And I spoke with Anne also about this, and I said, this is the situation, and what do you think about this? And she said, you know, I mean, when you say yes to somebody, you need to achieve that. And I told Ron about this, well, middle of the season 2000. And he said to me, but you're crazy or what? I said, you imagine? I mean, I say, well, for me, the choice I make, it was the right choice because I compare my time and compare my works with the best driver in the world on this time. I drove the best car in my life. I'm working for the best team. I don't regret anything, really. I mean, even if Williams in 2000 did a so good job and the car was performed very well, Jason did a good job, you know. But I'm not jealous, really. I'm just saying, yeah, I mean, happy for them.
Interesting, too, that you said a moment ago that Craig Pollock and Jacques Villeneuve approached you about BAR, both of them.
When Craig Pollock called me and called Didier and said, look, we want to have you on board for 2001 because we need to have two drivers working hard, testing a lot, make a progress for the team. And I think the season I did with McLaren, everybody saw term the lap time, but my input and my heart I put to McLaren to have a success with Mika and David. I think everybody know I'm working hard.
I think you got more positive publicity in 2000 testing for McLaren than you would have got if you'd been second half of the grid racing.
Sure. I'll never forget what said Ron Dennis, Martin Wichmarsch, Adrien Newey, all of the engineer and Mika and David about me. I never forget that because it was true or not, I don't mind, but he played the game with me. When I signed with Ron, Ron said to me, when you make the test, and Adrien confirmed that to me, you all the time have the same car to David and Mika, all the time. And not give to you the shit works. When you have the hard works to do, you do it, but during the test, one day you have the car to play and to enjoy.
We've discussed the difference between Prost Grand Prix and McLaren. So what kind of team did you walk into at BAR? Was it very much Jacques Villeneuve's team? Did you feel that?
No. I mean, really, I know Jacques by the past. In terms of teammate, he's one of the best teammates I have during these two seasons. Really. For sure, now we are very good friends. Huh? Still very good friends. But when I came to BAR, I have very good welcome by the old engineer, by Greg Pollock, and all the people, and all the people, because I working with them before.
Were there a lot of the same Honda people at BAR who had been at Mugello?
Yeah, someone. Right. It's mean I know some people when I come. And but Jack was very open with me. I know Jack before, but not like I never been working with him. And it was funny. I mean, it was funny because I did all the winter test. I don't do it because he was, you know, he was take time to recover of the season. And my engineer was Joe Clear and David Lloyd when I make the test, of course.
Both of whom are now at Ferrari, aren't they?
Exactly. And he was two of them was David Lloyd. I was love him because and Joe, he was so big engineer, and but he was Jack engineer. It was funny because one day he called Jack. He said, Jack, I think you need to come to test. And he said, oh, I mean, why? You need to come to test because the French kids, he never stop. We learn a lot of things. We achieve a lot of things. And you need to come and to start to work with him and just compete and working together. And Jack came. And for sure, we work hard, me and Jack together, to build the team to improve. All the the ambience of the team was really good. The complicity of the driver and the engineer was unbelievable. And I never feel he gave more to Jacques compared to me. Never, ever.
And how quick was Jacques Villeneuve?
Jacques, he was very fast, but very special. He want to drive with a special setup. Sometimes I don't understand the way he was quick with the setup like this, but he's fast. He don't care about accident or whatever. But when you are faster to him, he respects you also. He said to me when we fight in quali on the race, and he said, "Ah, you do a better job to me. I'm shit this weekend." He's like this, Jacques. He's why I love him. He's why I'm still very good friend with him. Why we meet still to meeting together. Because he's like this, but he's very talented.
He's quite a controversial character now. His opinions are very strong. I guess he was like that as a driver as well about the car.
Yeah, sometime. But wasn't funny with Jacques because I know him very well. He's working on television now. He's a showman. He criticizes something. I'm just laugh because he's not a real Jack. Jack, he told you what he thinks. But sometimes criticism, the way he criticizes, for me, is for the show. And sometimes I send, when he do the commentary, I send to him text message, I just shut up. I mean, what you talking? What the shit you talking about? And we have fun together because I just say, look, stop it. You don't need this controversy sometime. But he just sent to me a smiley and, you know, I mean, he's a jack. I mean, but you know, when you hear what he said on television and what he's talking about, 95% is right. Sometimes he's going a bit crazy or some people he don't like or he'd like.
He's an intelligent man. There's no doubt about that.
It is very much, very much.
It was a frustrating end to the BAR story. 2002, so much unreliability. Did it remind you of Prost in certain ways, the way it ended?
No, not because it was different things. When Greg Pollard was sacked, I feel it was not the right choice for the team and for the view we have with Jacques for the future of the team. When this changed, for me, was already thinking of my future because I know Greg quite well, I know Jacques quite well, I know all the team quite well, and I think we built something to have a success one day. And I trust this situation. And when the team principal changed to David Richards.
So this was the winter of 2001, 2002, wasn't it? December.
Yes. I have a meeting with David Richards. Nice meeting, to be honest. He never been Formula One before, if I'm not wrong. He came with different ideas. I don't feel good with that. And after that, start to play game with different things on the team. And the view I have on the BAR team and the way he going, it was not for me. It was too much politics and too much fight between somebody in the team. Even with Jacques, not our relationship was still good and even more closer. because we felt about this ambience. The game some people want to play, I was not like it at all. And when we have phone call to Toyota, I go into this meeting with KK in Toyota, and we have with Ove Anderson and all of people of Japanese people, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, we have very good meeting and they want me for two years firm, plus two more years. And when I know the game of David Richard, I don't trust him in this moment. I decided to send to Toyota because he just signed Jason Button. He wants to keep me and Jason. I know the contract of Jacques Villeneuve have with BAT, something it was not going well. And also because of that, I say I signed to Toyota, but I said to Didier and KK, listen to me. We announced to him 10 minutes before the announcement because he plays something with me I don't like. I want to give back a bit of my personality.
So is this summer 2002 we're talking? This is when you made the decision to leave BAR?
Yes.
I'm interested that Toyota were interested in a Honda driver, effectively.
Yeah, but what he was interesting by what I did by the past. He want a driver not to win a race. He want a driver working for McLaren. Of course, the best car, best team. He want a very hard worker on the test. And also, I don't think so. He don't want a politics man, and I'm not. And I think the discussion we have together was pretty productive, and with Ove Anderson too, and with Ange Pasquali, and this time was French director sportif. And I think he want to making something change, and is why I think he take me and Cristiano D'Amata came to champion of IndyCar. We have very good lineup and very good relationship. And when I saw how much Toyota invest technically, financially, to have a success, it was maybe one of the team we have success.
Were there similarities, a lot of similarities between BAR and Toyota? Both had a lot of money. Both were owned by big corporations. Neither of which were specialist racing companies. One was owned by a tobacco company, the other by the biggest car manufacturer in the world. Did it have a similar feel?
Not really, because these two teams were so different. You have one big team like BAR Honda with 500 people. I came to a team, huge team, Toyota, brand new more or less. When I saw the facility at Toyota in Cologne, I never saw that in my life. Even in McLaren. To be honest, I just say, wow, just this for Formula One. And I said, well, with all this facility, all this money, all of the investment of the people we have, if I don't have success with that, I need to retire, to be honest. And it's what I did. But I was very pleased. But it was different culture of BAR, different people, different technical background. It was not the same. But I thinking about this, you feel I restart to zero to build something. This is part of my life, I think.
Did that interest you to be there, grow the team?
Because when I saw the tool, the motivation he had to get me in board, and the time he wanted, I stayed with them to develop the team, and the way he listened to me to improve everything we can, the quicker is possible, to me and Cristiano and Ange Pasquali also. I never work a team like this apart McLaren. It's mean we have 2 days meeting per week, even if we're testing, even if we're racing, just to create more and more and more to going quicker and quicker. I feel very involved of the team, even more to the drivers. And this, I like it very much. Also the technical view.
So why do you think Toyota failed ultimately? You've already said they had the infrastructure, they had the best factory. Where did it go wrong?
He's like a constructor. When he decides to stop, is the way maybe win the championship. Because the car, the last car he make before he decided to stop, I think is one of the best cars I've ever seen in Formula One. And when Pedro de la Rosa did the test with Pirelli with this car, the beginning of the test, it was this Toyota, the brand new Toyota. Even Ferrari want to buy, I think. Because the lap time, no, but I'm serious. The lap time he did was just unbelievable. And the number of aerodynamic we saw, all the things we make, this car is for sure is a winning car. I don't know championship, but he sure is a winning car. Even De La Rosa, he said to me, it's just unbelievable.
So are you talking about the 2009 Toyota?
Nine cars. When the brand new car go out, did some tests with Pirelli and Toyota decide to stop. But I tell you, in 2004, we already qualifying on third position in Indianapolis. We score points. We have a very strong team. 2005, when I decide to stop, it was funny also because when Ove Anderson and John Watt say to me, you want to continue with us? I say, of course I want, but if we have winning car next year? He said, I don't think so. And I said that for me, it's the time to stop because, oh, I'm continue 100% focus and I win the race and championship, or I need to do something else because to be in Formula One, I'm lucky to doing this for 12 years, but I want to win all the time. What everything I do, I want to win. I have 38 year old and this time. I invest so much me, my family, my personal human being. I want to do it again if I have a car to win. Otherwise, I say I don't feel I 100% motivate just to doing it, And I tell him that. And I say, no, I think I decide to retire. And when I retired in Japan, Dr. Saito come to me and he said, you need to stay with us for the future. I said, well, which way? I mean, it was nice of you. And first of all, I give you my racing car like a present. I was so happy with that. And 1 week after, I have still a phone call to Ove Anderson and John Watt. I said, we need to talk to you. I need to meet you. Donc, we again go, I go there. And he proposed to me to do 1 year reserve driver and 2 years test driver. On my mind, I said, well, why not? What I like is to drive a car, to make progress technically with the team, to help them to be better. I say, I'm sure I know I don't have promotion to China or whatever, what I did by the past. You're sure I'm just doing this? He said, yeah, we promise to you, just reserve drivers and test driver. And the second year, I say, I don't want to be reserve driver to fly over the world. I did enough. I just want to be test driver. And he gave me a very good contract and put me in the team even more technically with all the engineer and everything. I enjoy it very much. You know what I like is to drive a car. I love Formula One. It's part of me. I enjoy so much. I don't regret any choice. I was lucky to do this job. If I'm here today, happy with family and my life is because it's Formula One. And this I don't forget.
What lovely words. Couple of other things. Who was the best teammate you ever had? You talked at length about Jacques Villeneuve, but obviously, you did races with Johnny Herbert, with Martin Brundle. Obviously, Jarno Trulli, you did a lot of time with.
Luckily, the first year I have fantastic teammate. He was Eric Bernard, French guy.
You both finished on the podium in Hockenheim. That was amazing.
But I never have a teammate give to me so much advice when I come to Formula One. This guy was just amazing. Even if I against him, he was unbelievable to help me all the time. And I love to work with Jarno Trulli. For me, in qualifying in one lap, I think he's one of the quickest guy I've ever seen in my life. In qualifying lap, this guy was just amazing. But to be honest, to complete works with a teammate, it was Jacques Villeneuve.
How much would you like to test a modern Formula One car? How much would you like to test the 2020 Mercedes?
I love to test. I don't think so. It's physically I managed doing it, but...
How's your neck these days?
My neck is good, but after the test, I think after two laps, it disappears. But I still racing after racing again. I love racing, but I'm turned 55 this year. For sure, if somebody give me a test just to enjoy, for sure I'm doing it because I love this. And I want to know what is the new Formula One, because when I have the time I have, or me and Jacques, we have, it was so exciting. I don't know if it's the same exciting car we have before. I have no idea. I don't want to argue about this. But yeah, if somebody say to me, you want to test, for sure I'm doing it.
Olivier, thank you so much for your time. It's been wonderful to catch up. Really good to see you.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
How fantastic to hear from Olivier again. I always felt he was underrated as a driver and feel he certainly deserved to win more than one race. But he has such a great perspective on racing, and I loved his descriptions of working with Alain Prost, Flavio Briatore and Ron Dennis. And I still can't believe he turned down that 2000 drive with Williams. What might have been, Monsieur Panis? Olivier, many thanks for your time. It was great to catch up again. And if you're coming to Monaco this week, I look forward to seeing you there. Before we move on, as ever, please remember to send in any stories or chance meetings or thoughts that you have on Olivier. And remember, I'll read the best ones next week. Send them to me at TomClarksonF1 or use the hashtag F1BeyondTheGrid. And if you like all things Monaco, stay tuned at the very end of the show for a special teaser. Which brings me on to what you sent in about Romain Grosjean after last week's show. And by the way, how great was it to see him on pole at the Indy Grand Prix over the weekend and finishing on the podium? Back where you belong, Romain. Christian Svensson sent in this message. Thank you, Tom and Romain. I listened to the pod while on a run and couldn't hold back my tears. I'm, like Romain, a father of three, and Romain's story has made me appreciate life just a little more. Couldn't be happier for him when he grabbed a pole and a podium in IndyCar. Well said, Christian. Romain is an inspiration to us all. Richard Ocock added this. Remarkable podcast, Tom. Romain is pure inspiration. Developing one of the most amazing motor racing careers, here's to many more decades up front. Hear, hear, Richard. I think Romain wishes he were racing at the Indy 500 this year, don't you? I think we need to watch that space for 2022. And Cocky thinks this. Great interview. Romain has gone from F1 driver to world-class philosopher. Loved his insight about driving and life. Just as I finished listening to the podcast, he got his first IndyCar pole. What a thrill. It was indeed a thrill for everyone who's followed his career, Cocky. Thanks, everybody, for sending in your messages. And as ever, we got loads. And I'm sorry I couldn't read them all out. But please remember that I read each and every one of them. Well, that's it for this week. I hope you've enjoyed hearing from Olivier again. And remember to send in your thoughts and stories. And as ever, I'll be back next week with another great guest from the world of Formula One. So see you then. Beyond the Grid is produced by F1 in association with Audioboom. Until next time, keep it flat out.